module 4 is part of it's from chapter 4, part of it's from 16. This is not going to be on Wednesday's test, Thursday's test. So what we're doing the rest of today is this stuff that will be on test number 2 4 weeks from now. So we're going to talk about the labor market. Did we start this chapter here? I'm starting to have a flashback to that.
Yeah.
So, okay, supply of labor, average work week. Price of substitutes and the substitutes for labor, machines, productivity of the trading mill.
Yeah,
I'm like, okay. This is still for the next test, right? Yeah, this is for the next step. Yeah, we did. Okay. Okay. Did we stop here? Is anybody here?
Marshall, who's supposed to
call? I think you stop at my pile of people who don't tell.
And then?
The person who's called.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, well, let me back up. Those of you following along on the internet, we had a week off accidentally, so it's been 2 weeks. Oh, so we apparently, theoretically, ended a long, long time ago with the idea of if you're going to hire somebody, the question is marginal physical product. How much stuff is that person going to bake? Was it maybe Matthew? We were hiring Matthew to bake cakes?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So how many extra cakes is Matthew going to make? Then we convert that into margin revenue product. How much money are we going to be able to get from selling those extra cakes that he makes? If he can make 10 an hour, we can sell each one for 20 bucks a piece. Well, he's going to get us an extra $200 an hour. But then you put that with margin resource cost. The third one is what is it going to cost us to hire him to get us $200 worth of cakes? How much is his salary going to be? How much do we have to do on unemployment benefits, social security contributions, health care, dental care, vacation days? The fact that I've got to give pay raises maybe to some of my other workers to keep them from getting mad and quitting and leaving because he's getting paid however much he's getting paid. So you got to put all of that together, and then you come up with the, well, if all those costs are still less than that $200 worth of cakes that he's going to make me, what do I do? I hire him. I gave everybody pay raises. I hire him and I put him to work and enjoy the leftovers because the leftovers is what? More profit in my pocket. Right. So that is a marginal cost, marginal benefit type thing. And did we do this? I know we did in human resources. So here we go. So it starts out with when you're going to start a company, you got to start by asking to figure out how many workers you need, you got to ask. Well, what's the work to get done? Remember the three determinants of labor, of course not, from a few slides earlier. The first one to determine how many workers we need is the demand for our product. We're not going to hire Matthew if we can't sell any cake. If we don't need any, nobody's wanting to buy our cakes, we don't need to hire any cooks. I don't need to hire any employees to help me make chicken eagle lip soup, get my eagle lip soup because ain't nobody can buy it, so I can't sell it, so I don't need to hire anybody. So you start out with asking, how much work do I need to get done? In this case, I've done the math, whatever, and I need to produce 10,000 t-shirts a month. Maybe I'm the manager, supervisor for a particular division, and I've got my team and my employees, and they're like, you go, you got to make 10,000 t-shirts. Month. So my boss is telling me I've got to do 10,000 t-shirts a month. Well, what does it take to make 10,000 t-shirts a month? Well, my workers can only make 10 t-shirts an hour. That means I've got 1,000 hours worth of work to get done each month. And I can't do it myself. And so what I look at, my workers work 8 hours shift, 8 hours a day. So I have 125 days worth of work to get done each month. Yeah, I got that. So I got 125 days worth of work to get done. And generally, you know, my people, they want their weekends, that kind of stuff. So generally, I've got 20 days a month that people are going to work. So 125 divided by 20, I'm gonna need 6 1/4 people. That's 6 1/4 people working for me, each making 10 t-shirts an hour, 40 hours a week, 20 days a month. I'll get exactly my 10,000 t-shirts. That's my starting point. So I don't have to just blindly, I don't know, let me hire some people and see what happens. You do a little bit of math. I need to hire 6 1/4 people. 6 ain't enough. So what do you do? Maybe you do 7 people, like what Shane just said. Because if I do 6 1/4 people, okay, I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All of y'all are my employees. And, yeah, y'all are my employees. Are any of you ever going to call in sick? Yeah. Are any of y'all ever going to, I don't know, want to take a vacation day sometime? Yeah. So even if I had each of y'all and Will came in for 10 hours a week, so a lot of y'all going to be calling in sick? 6 1/4 people would barely do it. In fact, perfect attendance, 6 1/4 people would exactly do it. You'll never have perfect attendance. So maybe I'll round up. So I technically have more workers than I need, but that's okay because if people call in sick, I don't have to worry about it. I'll still get the work done. If nobody calls in sick, I'll get ahead of the game. Maybe I'll have leftover t-shirts in the drawer that I can use next month. Or maybe, well, I'm only going to do 6 people because I'm not going to mess with Craig and Will in for 10 hours a week. But I'll do, I'm going to hire 6 of y'all, and I'm going to, you know, okay, everybody, we're going to be, the job is 40 hours a week plus 3 hours worth of overtime every week. Some people are fine with that. They like to get the time in half. They like working overtime. So that's the job. It's 43 hours a week, 3 of them being overtime. Oh, and then everybody's got to work an extra hour for every day that somebody calls in sick during the course of the week. So that gets a little bit cranky because you don't know how many hours worth of overtime and workers you're gonna need to work your workers until like the end of the week, right? So when you figure out exactly how many people have called in sick, how many days during the course of the week, so suddenly all of y'all's overtime comes in on Friday. So 8 hours Monday, 8 hours Tuesday, 8 hours Wednesday, 8 hours Thursday, 15 hours on Friday. Are y'all okay with that? Yeah, there might be some issues there. So. Maybe I'll make people do overtime. Maybe to handle that extra quarter of a person, I'll have a temp come in a couple of days a week. Like Will. He's not a full-time employee. I'll just have him come in 2 days a week as a temp and bring him in extra times when somebody calls in sick. Maybe I'll end up borrowing employees from another department to come in and help out one day a week. You come in here and you work for us, and the other 4 days a week you go do your own job. You have the options. Which is better? The answer is it depends on just what that number is. If it's 6 1/2, if it's 6 3/4, yeah, you certainly you don't want 7. But if it's 6.01, well, that's more than 6. But if it's 6.01, maybe just a 20 minutes worth of overtime out of one worker, and that's all you need. Part of that is your personality as a manager. Are you comfortable with the I only got 6 workers, I gotta work them overtime, and I don't know how many hours I gotta make my people work each week, and I don't know whether I gotta make my schedule each week or versus me.
Step on a lot more stressful than just hiring 7 people.
Yeah, it's a lot more stressful than hiring 7 people, but you may end up ultimately spending more money than you should. But you might spend more money than you should the other way around because a couple of y'all call in sick, and suddenly I've got Will coming in here 4 or 5 days a week as a temp, and not only do I have to pay him, well, the temp agency gets a cut of it too. And let's face it, Will being a temp, he's going to be sufficient as the rest of y'all and stuff. So maybe I got to bring in 2 temps at the end of the week to make up for the work for a couple of y'all to call in sick a couple of days. The answer is it kind of depends. Your ultimate goal is to make sure you have the employees you need to match workload. If you only need 6 1/4 people, you ain't going to hire 3. You're not going to go with 12. You're going to be shooting somewhere in the 6 or 7 area. Otherwise, you're wasting money, wasting your time. Overstaffing would be the, well, what if you round up to 7? You have a little bit more worker than you need. Plus, it could cost you extra money because you're paying for more worker than you need. You think hiring 7 full-time workers when you really only need 6 1/4, but you get extra flexibility. Because maybe jumping down to the last bullet point is If I want to train somebody to do something else, we get new equipment, show y'all how to do it. We need to take a couple hours to do maintenance on the machines, that guy's, it's okay. Because we've got enough extra work, we can catch up, right? You can train people, you can then give them extra responsibilities to do other stuff so you don't have to do as much work. I can take the time not only to show y'all how to make the t-shirts, but I can like start training y'all one at a time how to work the security system and that kind of stuff. So the first one y'all that shows up at 8 o'clock in the morning can turn off the alarm and come in and cut on the machines and get things going so I can be lazy and come in at 10, right? Because I'm lazy. So you have that flexibility there, but efficiency for you accounting people, you know who you are. Yeah, you accounting people, your efficiency is dropping because you divide the number of t-shirts by the number of workers and that number is going to be smaller if you care about efficiency. But here you go. We're understaffing. Well, what if we only do that? Let's do we 6 and a quarter people. Let's just be 6 people and make them do, you know, make everybody work a little overtime. Or we'll mess with some pens. We can easily get behind schedule with that. Obviously, we looked at, and it might end up costing you more if you try to make up that difference. Paying people overtime, that's time and a half. So that's equivalent of if I'm making people work overtime for 10 hours worth of work, that's paying $15, 15 hours worth of money for 10 hours worth of work, right? And then when you start tacking on everybody that calls in sick, that's a pay, day of regular pay that's going out the window being replaced by 8 hours worth of overtime to make up for it at time and a half. Those costs may end up escalating and going past real fast. But here's something you can't ignore. You can bring out some serious creativity. Good. Yeah. We got no problem meeting schedule, getting stuff done on time. Everybody's like, we're getting our work done. We got time to horse playing, goof off, and that kind of stuff. Is anybody thinking, how can we do this better? No. But if you are working overtime on Friday night for the 35th Friday night in a row, somewhere along the line, you're going to start asking the question of, there's got to be a better way. And there's a question. Ooh, James. Not all the way over here. Your workers, somebody is going to start asking this kind of question, and maybe there's maybe better ways that you think will get figured out. And in case you're not yet, this actually happens. I told in the human resources class, when I was working for Conseco Finance, we're sitting there doing these loans and that kind of stuff, and there's crap that we're doing for each loan that we're doing, and we end up doing some of the same stuff 3 different times. Filling out 3 different forms that had basically 2/3 of the information was the same on all 3 forms, that kind of stuff. And I'm like, I'm tired of working overtime, staying late Friday night because I'm having a hard enough time getting the day to this. And I'm going to spend all my Fridays doing this. So I looked at my boss and I'm like, here's a better way. You give me half a day. And he did. He gave me half a day and I sat down and I made an Excel spreadsheet that had one list. Then when you did the one list, it filled out all 3 of the forms. I rebuilt the 3 forms in Excel kind of thing. And then we just had this one running file that we kept with each loan. And we just updated it as it went. 3 forms were automatically done. So what took us probably 30, 40 minutes per loan to do got dropped down to 10 minutes per loan to do. So that 4 hours that he gave me that one morning to do it, we pretty much made up for that afternoon with the increased productivity with this new thing that I made. But of course, you know, we're doing something new with something thrown together in a 4-hour Excel spreadsheet. That's maybe part of why we went bankrupt, but anyway. Actually, that was the insurance side, not the mortgage side. But and actually, the little thing, not that little form thing is a little bit informed what we did when we shut down Seco, when we started the mortgage company for GME. That thinking process actually went into it, so. But they shut down. But you get creativity when we're running behind, we're working like dogs, there's got to be a better way. That question doesn't get asked when you weigh that schedule. So, this is kind of related to the earlier, determinants of demand for labor, so it's not like I don't quite, it's a little bit different, I don't know why I have them separate here. But why would you want to hire workers or hire more workers? Because change in productivity, which is one of those three, you can get more work done. If I can hire Matt and he makes me, what's it, 10 gigs an hour? Maybe I'll hire him, maybe I can't. But if I can get this newer, faster oven that by hiring Matt, I can get 30 cakes an hour out of it, that makes hiring him sound a whole lot better, right? So increases in productivity, these increases in technology might actually push for more hiring in some certain situations. But then, of course, if you're replaced by a machine, that's a problem. But then changes in what way of product demand related to that is product price. Okay, you can only make 10 cakes an hour and we're selling those cakes for $20 a piece. Maybe I hire, maybe not. But if I can sell those cakes for $40 a piece, makes that math look a little bit better. Are you with me? Okay, so that what we did a week and a half ago, last time we were here, and what we just did now, we've been thinking from the company's point of view, the demand point of view, the company wanting workers. Now we're going to flip the pancake over to the other side. Talk about labor supply. This is where you are. This is you right now. Labor supply. You are supplying the workers that companies need. This is the one time you realize you are on the supply side of things. It is your and my willingness and ability to work. Set the rest of that one aside. Your specific one. Are you willing to work? Are you able to work? Some of you are willing and able to work. Some of you not willing, not able. What determines your willingness and ability to get a job instead of not having a job? Part of it is work conditions. Did the job have? Part of it is benefits. Maybe, you know, people are out there that they're not working for the pay, they're working for like health insurance and that kind of stuff. Have y'all heard people talk about that? Yeah, we have some teachers here, some instructors here on this campus. The main reason why they're working is the health insurance, life insurance. Not necessarily paycheck. Paycheck's fine too, but they probably would have retired if it went for benefits. My retirement date is probably going to be pushed out a couple more years until I'll be technically able to retire, but I'm going to have to stick it out a couple more years until I can get my wife on Medicare. And then, change in the price of goods and services. I'm also going to add in, and I never actually type it in, and the demand or the need for goods and services. Actually, the other way, do it. Change in life circumstances. And I know you cannot read that. Change in life circumstances. For those of y'all that were not in 201 last semester, here's what happened. We've hinted at it a little bit, but here we go. Lovely. Her parents just love her to death. They think that she's just the greatest thing ever. Greatest thing since sliced bread. Mama loves her, daddy loves her. They bought her a car when she graduated high school, all that kind of stuff. They still do her laundry. They still give her some money for gas for the car. They take care of her books, that kind of stuff. They pack her lunch, do her laundry, all that kind of stuff. She's taken care of. So she gonna work? She don't need to. Why should you? Maybe I get a little bit of side job so I can get a little bit of money so I have it in my pocket if I want to go buy a CD. I listen to that screen music, so play a video game. No, she doesn't need work. So is she going to work? No. Think about half of the people you went to high school with. They didn't work. Why? Because they didn't need to. Because mom and dad were taking care of them, where they're like, your grades are terrible. No, we can let you work. She didn't need to work. Until that one interesting thing. So this thing comes flying up. She looks outside her window and she sees a face that looks like this. She gets whisked away to the stars, swept off her feet, whisked away to the stars, comes back home the next day. pregnant with an alien love child. And so Lovely's dad, I mean, and I talked to him, so he told me this is true. He looked at her and he's like, I don't think so. She said, Dad, it wasn't my boyfriend, it was the opposite W by aliens. He's like, I don't think so. No daughter of mine. We ain't gonna have it, not in this household, no, because you got your brothers, your sisters, get out. I don't think so. Get out. Lovely looked at mom, she just sort of shook her head in disappointment and walked away. Change in life circumstances. So now does Lovely need to work?
Yeah.
Yeah, because she is homeless now. She's got to get paid rent on a house. They kind of took her car keys before she went out the door because the car they bought it before she turned 18, so it still is in their name, not hers. So she's got no car, got no gas. She's got to pay for her own rent, pay for her own groceries. She's got to buy her own laundry detergent because she's got to do her own laundry because mom ain't taking care of that anymore. Not only counting whatever diapers for a tentacle alien love child thing, is that going to change or her need to get off the couch to get a job? Oh, yes. So for those of y'all that weren't here in 201, that was what happened. Just. And those of you that were here in 201, y'all remember that story. I mean, we lived it. Her willingness to get a job went from 0 to 100. Her ability to get a job, well,
0.
It went from 100, it went down a little bit because she got to get a job within walking distance of wherever her apartment is until she can get a bicycle and then, right? Until she gets three paychecks and she can buy a 73 Ford and over $100.
All for very deep tentacles.
Yes. So she's not only working, got to work more because of change in life circumstances, but she needs some health insurance. Would you agree? I think so. She needs health insurance. Change the price of goods and services. Now she's conscious that the price of diapers goes up. That's really going to hit home for her. So then the price of diapers goes up. She asks that much more because she's going to have to work, right? So these things are going to impact her willingness and ability to work. Her willingness and ability to go get a job instead of sitting home watching Judge Judy. Work conditions. Okay. How many of you would drop out of college right now and come work for me? I have a job. I have a business. I have a job. I'll pay you $20 an hour. Full-time job. Two of you. Two and a half of you. Okay. The job is you have to climb inside sewer pipes with a push broom and clean the inside of sewer pipes. Are you still interested?
I'm not getting paid by the hour.
Two of you. Carry stuff. Okay. All right, how many of you would drop out of school and take this job now, $20 an hour, if the job was you got to sit in a recliner, watch your favorite TV shows, and occasionally just have to pet a bunny rabbit? Yeah, work conditions. All of you raise your hands there. Unless somebody's like, I really got allergies. For $20 an hour, I can afford to buy a pill. Actually, I would drop out for that. Anyway, but the work conditions influence. If the jobs come around, it's like, oh, the only jobs I can find suck, no, maybe I'd rather stay home. If I can find a good job, maybe I'm willing to go ahead and step out. These are the things that go through our mind when we're thinking, do I want a job? Do I need a job? Determining whether we're going to try to get a job or not. And once you make that decision of, okay, I want a job, I need a job, I'm going to start looking for a job, then you have entered the labor force that we talked about sometime last semester, and we'll talk about, I think, a little bit later in this chapter. Because we have to make a trade-off, and we make this trade-off between money and free time. Lovely, a year ago, she didn't really need the money, she'd rather have the free time. She didn't need the money because she had everything taken care of. She didn't need money. She would rather stay home. Is she going to be 17, 18 years old? Is she going to sit there and say, well, I don't need the money, but I'm going to go ahead and work 40 hours a week and I'm going to take all that money and stick it in a 401k so I can retire earlier? No. No, she has taken a couple of accounting classes, so she might be just a little bit failing that. How many of y'all, more money is better than less money? Okay, why are y'all not working overtime? Why do y'all not have two jobs?
I have three.
Okay, I'm sorry, Bobby. Bobby has three jobs, but the rest of you, why not more? Why are you not working more? Because what's the point of having money if you ain't got the time to spend it? All right, what's the point of having money if you ain't got time to enjoy it? So you make that trade-off. Anytime you're making a decision, I'm going to work more, that means you're automatically giving up free time in order to work more. And we all make that trade-off. We all make that decision. Is it worth it for me to work more? Is it worth it for me to work less? How many of you have ever, like, you called in sick and you weren't really sick? You took a mental health day? You know, your friends are going to the lake and you just, okay, thank you for admitting. Thank you. What I mean. You're like, Jordan's like, I'm not really sick, but my friends are going to go to the lake and I'm going to go to the lake with them. He would rather have had the leisure time of hanging with his friends at the lake than the extra money he would have gotten at work that day.
So you get your paycheck and you see how much less money.
Yes, until he gets a paycheck, he's like, oh, snap, and then, okay. What he does from there, well, we'll see. But it's opportunity cost is the words here. Every extra hour you're working, what are you giving up? If you have a life like Jordan, you have friends like Jordan, giving up free time to go to work, that's an issue. More time he's working, the less time he's hanging with his crew. Where somebody like Carrie that doesn't have a life whatsoever, no, the more time he's working, he's giving up time that he's sitting. You know, sitting, staring out the window, waiting to see if Grandpa is going to pop his head up in the field right there next to the house. That's pretty much all he's got going for. So, he would be more willing to go get a job than Jordan would. Right. Sorry.
It's okay. He's going to be.
But of course, if you're sitting holding a rifle and you look for Grandpa, then that's okay. I'm fully on board with that. Okay. So for Carrie, he ain't got much going on, so it ain't much sacrifice for him to give up doing what he's doing to go get a job. Where Jordan has a lot going on, so it's a bigger sacrifice. He's giving up more to go to work than Carrie is. So consequently, what I have here, he would expect and demand a higher paycheck. Carrie would be willing to take a job at $8, $10, $12 an hour. That's fine because he ain't giving up much in order to take that job. For Jordan, maybe given everything he's got going on in his life and everything he's got going on in his day, maybe he might take $15, $20 an hour to get him off the couch. But here's the fun one, the weird one, that marginal utility of income, the extra usefulness you get from money goes down the more money you get. You only have a little bit of money, what are you going to spend it on? The things that are most important to you, the things you most need, the things you most want. Then if you get more money, then you're going to buy stuff that you kind of need, kind of want, right? Then you get even more money, then you get stuff that you maybe need, maybe want. Then you get even more money, then you buy stuff that you don't really want. How many of y'all are willing to work more in order to just get extra money so you can buy stuff that you don't really want? So if we were actually, did I grasp it? No. If I was, I should have it somewhere. If I was to grasp the labor supply curve, you know, normal supply curve goes up, right? The labor supply curve, I'm sure I have one somewhere. It actually turns back. The more money you make, the less willing you get to a point where you're willing to work less. Okay. I have a job and I'm paying you $1 million an hour. How much are you going to work?
30 hours, 40 hours.
How much? Okay, I'm getting a not much. Yeah, $30 an hour. Something. I'm gonna work as much as I can for 2 weeks, and I'm gonna retire for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But if you're only making $50 an hour, well, $50 is better than $20 an hour. Maybe you're willing to work more, but you're really gonna start. You know, look, you'll let me work like a dog and make $50 an hour and retire when I'm 45. The higher the wages go, the less interested in the long term we actually get in working. We'll give enough money that enough is good enough. So, my 201 refugees, you recognize this. Nominal and real wages. Actually, here you might recognize this places, okay? Nominal, remember word of this, comes from whatever word the word name comes from. For those of you English major or whatever, that thing is where you study where words came from. Nominal wages, that's the amount of money that, the amount of dollars that you get. We don't work for money. How many of you work for money? You don't. Will, sorry, walked into that trap. So, Will, you get your paycheck, you go to the bank every Friday, and you say, I like it all at once, please. Then you take these dollar bills and go home, and you spread them out on the floor of your room, and start swinging, going like that, and duck, saying, order the money. Is that what you do? No. Why are you working? To get the stuff that the money can buy you. So we're not, we're, Will is, what is your favorite drink?
Soda.
Good answer. And he said so straight face, he was like, almost believe him. So, and he's not his head. We're very convincing, I'm impressed. Actually, you have brought stuff up. Will only drinks, so that's all he buys, is Sun Drop. So if he's making $100 a week and Sun Drops are selling for a dollar a piece, he's working to get, he ain't working for $100, he's working to make enough money to buy 100 cans of Sun Drop. If the price of Sun Drop goes up, what does he need? He needs an increase in his paycheck so he can still be able to afford to buy 100 cans of Sun Drop. That's what we end up needing to think about when we talk about our quality of life, our standards of life, and you know, you're working to get an education, and that kind of stuff, so you can improve your standard of living. The question is, can you buy more with your paycheck this year than you could have last year? In Will's case, if he only buys Sun Drop, can he buy more Sun Drop with a paycheck this year than he could last year? If he can, he's improved his standard of living. If he can't, he's fallen behind. So one thing we have to look at is inflation that we talked about last semester, pricing. How much is, in this case, Sun Drop going up? And is his paycheck going up at least as fast as the price of Sun Drop? If Sun Drop goes up to $1.10 a can, but then his paycheck only went up to $105 a month, he went from making enough money to buy 100 cans of Sun Drop, now he's only making enough money to buy like 96 cans of Sun Drop. His paycheck is larger. So the boss is like, I gave you pay raise, shut up and get out. But in reality, he can't buy as much Sun Drop as he could afford. So you have to be aware, you need to pay attention to what the inflation rate is and make sure that your paycheck is going up equal to that amount at least each year or you fall in behind. So we work for the goods and services that we can buy with our paycheck. That is our real wage. So, how much do you make an hour? Feel free to lie. You make it $9 an hour. So he's working, he's making 9 Sun Drops an hour, is this current wage. Price of Sun Drop goes up and his paycheck doesn't, well, he may only be working for 8.5 Sun Drops an hour, or 8 Sun Drops an hour. That's what? That's a pay cut. How many of you would be happy if you walk into work tomorrow and your boss says, I'm giving you cut and pay? You're not. And your homework assignment is to be, if you haven't gotten a pay raise equal to the inflation rate in the last year, you need to talk to your boss about getting a pay raise equal to the inflation rate. So your standard of living will be the same as it was before.
Actually, at Food Lion, one thing they're starting to do is they're giving the employees free water and they keep a basket of fruit in the break room.
Really?
And someone was like, well, rather than just give us all a raise, I'm like, well, if you just ate food, drink water of the gay list, you're not spending more money on stuff that you buy from the universe.
Yes. Good way to think about it, but it sucks if you don't like water or you don't like fruit. And so that can be an issue for people like me. So, nominal wage. Will's paycheck went up by 8% a year. But the price of and stuff he buys only goes up by 5% a year. What happens? He can buy 3% more stuff this year than he could last year. Good for you.
Congratulations. It's just sort of that simple.
But what is it going to take for Will to justify getting a pay raise higher than the inflation rate? He's getting a bigger piece of the pie than he was getting before, percentage-wise. Why is the boss going to pay him more money? Because he can do more. He's baking more cakes. He's shucking more corn. He's assassinating more chickens. He's whatever it is that he's doing. The more of them that he can do an hour, the more of them he can do a day, the more of them he can do a week, the more the boss can justify paying him. Matthew comes up and said, I'm making 10 cakes an hour. I need a pay raise. I can't help you because I barely afford to hire you the 10 cakes an hour you're doing. But if Matthew comes back a couple weeks later, a couple months later, said, hey, I've improved. I've learned more, and I can bake 12 cakes an hour. Because he's making 12 cakes an hour instead of 10, that's putting an extra $40 in my pocket. Does that give me some room to give him a pay raise? Yeah. Because he's making me an extra $40 an hour or a day or whatever. So that gives the justification for sharing it. But if Matthew goes from, I used to make 10 cakes an hour, now I'm only making 8 cakes an hour. It's getting toward the, we gotta let somebody go. Time to make a change. It's not you, it's me. No, it is you. Right. Change had to be made there. But increases in real wage leads to inflation. If Will's boss is gonna say, I went from giving you 100 sun drops a week to now I'm giving you 110 sun drops a week, that's more sun drops than I'm paying you. And where am I going to get the money for these sun drops that I'm paying you? I'm going to have to raise my prices. So prices do go up in this situation. We're okay with that. Prices go up, but he's got more sun drops. His income goes up more than prices. We're okay. So those of you whose productivity doesn't improve, you don't get a pay raise, you're falling behind in the face of those people with pay raises whose pay is going up and real wages is going up. But overall, increased productivity tends to be a overall good thing for the customer. So be more productive and see what happens. Any questions? Okay. Yeah, we know where you're going. Okay. So we will find a way.